Welcome to my classroom again. I am Nesli. In this video, I will try to explain how we can produce a Nernst potential in an experimental setup. So, we know that for ions to move through the cell membrane, or in other words, for an ionic current to be possible, there must be a force that pushes the ion through the ion channels. This force can be of two types, chemical and electrical. The chemical force is produced by the concentration difference of our ion in the intracellular and extracellular fluids. And the unit of it is millimolars. Nernst potential is important at that point, and it helps us to convert the unit of millimolars into millivolts. Therefore, by the help of Nernst potential, we are able to express the chemical force in millivolts as if it is an electrical potential difference. So, every ion that has a concentration difference between the inner and outer parts, the intracellular and extracellular fluids, can produce an electrical potential difference across the membrane if the conditions are supplied. What are the necessary conditions? One, there must be a concentration difference for the ion. Two, for this ion to pass through the cell membrane, the membrane must be permeable to this ion, which means there must be ion channels in the membrane. The third, and another important point, is that the accompanying ions, for example, if our ion is a positive ion, the accompanying ion is a negatively charged ion, anion. If the ion we're talking about is an anion, the accompanying ions are cations. So these accompanying ions must not be able to pass through the cell membrane. So there must not be any channels on the cell membrane for the accompanying ions. So, I have chosen the example of potassium to explain how a concentration difference for an ion coming together with ion channels can produce an electrical potential difference at the cell membrane. Let us see our conditions. We know that potassium concentration is higher in all of our cells. So we have a chemical force here, which coming together with the potassium channels that I have placed on the membrane, will be able to produce a potassium movement. The next thing that I need to add is that this potassium concentration difference is going to produce an electrical potential difference. So I don't want any electrical potential difference here, because the electrical potential difference that I'm going to measure at the end of our experimental setup must be only produced by the potassium concentration difference. So therefore I placed equal numbers of positive and negative charges in the intracellular fluid and the extracellular fluid, which means these areas are neutral. More important than this, the inner side and the outer side of the membrane is neutral. So I have placed equal numbers of positive and negatively charged ions on two sides of the membrane, because everything that is going to happen is going to happen in a narrow neighborhood, which is limited to the neighborhood of our membrane. Now, let us start. The experimental setup is ready. Let us start to produce the result. So, at the beginning, we have a chemical force. I am going to use color coding. So, chemical force, I will show with a black arrow. The electrical force I will show with yellow arrows, and the net electrochemical force, the sum of these, I'm going to show by green arrows. At the beginning, we have a chemical force. For potassium, this chemical force is pushing potassium out of the cell, and then the size of my arrow is showing the amplitude of this concentration force. At the beginning, I do not want to have any electrical potential difference across the cell membrane, so it is zero. If you have a look at the net electrochemical force, we are going to see that the net electrochemical force is exactly equal to the chemical force, because this is the only force now. This means that now we have a force and the channels. What is going to happen? Positively charged potassium ions are going to move out of the cell. Negatively charged accompanying ions will not be able to follow potassium. So we are going to have a potential difference. At this point, I need to stress two important things. What are they? One, the potassiums that move out of the cell are coming from a very limited neighborhood next to our membrane. This means that the number of potassium ions that go out is able to produce, they're big enough to produce an electrical potential difference, but they are not, the number of potassium ions that move out is not big enough to change the concentration difference between the intracellular and extracellular fluids. This is the first important point. The next important detail is that the positively charged potassium ions will not move away from the membrane towards the rest of the extracellular fluid, or the negatively charged ions. What are they for potassium in the cell? They are proteins and phosphates. There are no channels on our cell membrane, so the negatively charged ions will not be able to follow. On the other side, negatively charged ions will not be able to move inward towards the intracellular fluid, because these positive and negative charges are going to attract each other across the cell membrane. So they will not move away from the cell membrane. So now we have an electrical force. The negative side of this electrical force is inside the membrane. This is going to attract the positively charged ions towards the cell. So, electrical force has been produced, and it is moving them, it is pulling the potassium ions toward the cell, but it is a little bit small at present. What happened to the chemical force is something that we have to think about. The chemical force, did it change? No, it didn't change. The amplitude of the chemical force is the same. Why? I'm going to repeat it again. The number of potassium ions that have moved out is from a very limited area, and this does not change the concentration difference for potassium. So our chemical force does not change. An electrical force in the opposite direction has been produced. Let's have a look at the net force, the electrochemical driving force. We see that it has decreased a little, but there's still a force, a net force, pushing potassium out of the cell. This means that potassium will continue to move out of the cell. Let's take this potassium out of the cell. The negatively charged proteins and phosphates will not be able to follow, and this is going to increase the electrical potential difference across the membrane. So, with the movement of more potassium ions outward, same question comes, will the chemical force change? No. Still, it's a small number. The chemical force is going to stay the same, but with movement of potassium ions out of the cell, the electrical force is going to grow bigger. The inside of the cell is going to be more and more negative, and this is going to create a force pulling potassium into the cell. So what will be our net electrochemical force? We see that it, as the electrical force increases, chemical force does not change, but the net electrochemical force is getting smaller and smaller. Still, there is a force. More potassium ions will move out. This is going to keep the negative ions inside, and the electrical potential difference is going to grow further. Chemical force is going to stay the same. Electrical force is going to grow bigger as potassium goes out, and the net force, net driving force, is going to get smaller and smaller. And these steps will be continuing until when? These steps are going to end only when the chemical force becomes equal to the electrical force. And what happens to the net electrochemical force? At this point, it is going to be zero. So, this is an equilibrium condition. The chemical force pushing outward is equal to the amplitude of the electrical force pushing inward, and there's no net electrochemical force, and the movement of potassium is going to stop at that point. This point where you find the electrical force that is equal to the chemical force is our Nernst potential for potassium, because there is no net potassium movement due to zero electrochemical potential. It is also called equilibrium potential. So, with this experimental setup, we started with a concentration difference and ion channels, and these worked together to produce an electrical force which is equal to the amplitude of our chemical force. Now we are able to express the chemical force in millivolts. It is the Nernst potential. It carries the name of potential and the unit of millivolts, and it makes you think it's an electrical potential, but please always keep in mind that when somebody talks about Nernst, it is in fact a chemical force. So in this video, I tried to explain how a concentration difference for potassium can produce an electrical force that is equal to the force of the concentration force. I hope it has been useful for you. Thank you for watching me.